children will come here. If they're singing in the adult choir, they'll be in the Advent choir. They will come here after Sunday school and rehearse while the parents are in the meeting. Finally, our Chancel choir is once again joining the choir at First United Methodist for a holiday concert that is this afternoon at 4 o'clock. Last year, it was a phenomenal concert, and I've been told it's even more wonderful this year. It's also free, so if you have time this afternoon, I encourage you to go and check it out. I'm sure it will be well worth your while. On the back of the bulletin, please note the special thoughts and prayers list. There are no updates today, but please keep these people in your thoughts throughout the week, as well as throughout the holiday season. And now as we enter into time of worship and celebration, let us recall these words from Thomas Merton. Our job is to love others without stopping to inquire whether or not they are worthy. The Greer family will now come and light our third Advent candle.
Today we light the candle at our Advent wreath, the candle of love.
We are reminded that the prophet of Micah teaches that what God requires is for us to do what is just and to show constant love.
Throughout the Bible, justice goes hand in hand with mercy, love, kindness, and compassion.
As we light this candle, we remember those who have shown us how to love even when doing so is not convenient or sensible, and we take up the challenge of acting out our love in the world.
Reaching for Rainbows by Ann Weeds. Can you imagine having to walk in those shoes? Can you imagine having to wear wooden shoes to school and clomp up and down the hall all day and up and down the stairs? They're actually called clomping. That's kind of the sound like when you walk in. They say if you wear really thick wool socks, it's pretty comfortable. Okay, so we're going to put those aside for a moment. I want to read you a story. I didn't make this up. I don't know if it's a true story, but I think it very well could be. Okay, here it goes. One day, a mother treated her two sons, Steve and Kevin, to ice cream cones. Okay, starting to do. Steve got a cone of mint chocolate chip, and Kevin got one of
put yourself in the other person's shoes, feel what they're feeling, and that will help you make the right decision. Thank you all for being here. Have fun Sunday school.
Thank you.
pages away from you. Amen.
Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Matthew. This is how the birth of Jesus took place. When Mary, his mother, was engaged to Joseph, before they were married, she became pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man. Because he didn't want to humiliate her, he decided to call off their engagement quietly. As he was thinking about this, an angel from the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because the child she carries was conceived by the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you will call him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." Now all of this took place so that what the Lord had spoken through the prophet would be fulfilled. "Look, a virgin will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel." Emmanuel means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did just as an angel from God commanded and took Mary as his wife. But he didn't have sexual relations with her until she gave birth to a son. Joseph called him Jesus. Will you join me for prayer and silent reflection? Loving God, it would be nice to have an angelic visit when life is difficult and the choices before us are confusing. Joseph was trying to do the right thing, and the angel said, "No, don't do that. Do this instead," which wasn't even one of the options. Love gets bogged down by practicality and stymied by social norms. We have trouble thinking outside the box and giving ourselves permission to dream wild and wondrous dreams. But Advent is a time of dreaming and hoping and remembering the love that allowed Joseph to defy all expectation. Help us to find that love in our own hearts. For this we pray, and now we offer the silent yearnings of our own hearts. Amen. During the height of the pandemic, when everyone was wearing their mask, I started using in earnest the little microphone that came with my hearing aids. And it worked really well, so much so that I now carry it with me everywhere. Even the kids are getting used to passing it around during the children's term. The other evening, them and I were working in the kitchen, and he was wearing the microphone, so he didn't have to stop what he was doing and turn around and look at me every time he had something to say. His voice was right in my ear, and we were talking almost like normal people. And then unbeknownst to me, that little yellow warning light started to blink on the microphone, so we took it off and plugged it into the charger. And all I knew was that suddenly he sounded so far away, and I had no idea what he was saying. Which is kind of how I felt moving from Mary's voice to Joseph's. In case you've missed the last couple of weeks, this Advent I'm exploring the voices beneath our beloved birth narratives in Luke and Matthew. Last week I looked at Mary's voice in the Annunciation in Luke, so it just seemed impressions received in dreams, Joseph first married Mary and then whisked his family to safety in Egypt, where they hang out for a while waiting for Herod's death, eventually returning to Israel and settling in the north to avoid the wrath of the new king. But all of that comes later. Before the dreams, Joseph is flying by the seat of his pants, with only his gut to follow and a desire for righteousness. He is engaged to Mary, but now she's pregnant. Easily a deal breaker no matter when and where you live, but especially complicated back then when one didn't simply return the gift and cancel the wedding. Once again, theologian Kelly Nakandeha provides helpful background. According to Nakandeha, betrothal was a legally binding part of the ancient marriage arrangement and occurred before the homegoing to the husband, family, and home. Breaking off the marriage at this point involved matters of law. A man in Joseph's position could ask for economic compensation in addition to the divorce, the impounding of the dowry, and possible return of the bride price. Just so you know, the bride price is pretty much what it sounds like. Money that the man paid to the family in order to marry the bride. So every source I read assured us this is not the actual buying of the bride. So Joseph could legally get that money back and keep the dowry. But doing so, Nakandeha tells us, would require public conversations with Joseph's community elders and would make known Mary's compromised condition. On the other hand, a quiet divorce would avoid compounding her shame, even if it meant forfeiture of his dowry. So a public divorce was within Joseph's rights, and it did make more sense economically. In a region hard hit with taxation, some might have argued that it was kind of stupid to not at least get your money back. On the other hand, a quiet divorce not only meant financial loss, but also social scorn, since Joseph's name would not have been publicly cleared. We might argue that the scriptures say that Joseph was a righteous man, so of course he wouldn't publicly humiliate Mary. But in Joseph's day, righteousness didn't mean being morally upright. It meant fulfilling the demand of the relationship, be it a relationship between two people or a relationship with God. Joseph had already fulfilled the demand of his relationship. Mary, he could presume, had not. So being righteous did not preclude his publicly divorcing Mary and getting the money. So why would he opt to annul the engagement quietly? Some folk today think he might have feared for Mary's life, assuming that she would have been stoned for her assumed adultery. Amy Jill Levine assures me that this is not the case. Levine suggests that likely Joseph was concerned for her reputation. Nakandeha elaborates to say that in Joseph, a different economic practice was at work. He valued Mary as a person beyond what sum of money he could demand. So much so that in spite of the pain that we can assume her pregnancy caused him, Joseph still seemed willing to accept a measure of shared shame to shield her from society's worst. giddy feelings we get when someone sweeps us off our feet. It's not just about our hearts melting when we hold a newborn baby. And it's not about that connection we feel to all of humankind when the lights are twinkling and the carols are ringing. Love is about what we do when all of those feelings are challenged. When our significant other has broken our heart. When our child has fallen into a deep well of destructive behavior and there's no way we can reach them. When humanity commits atrocities toward each other and toward the earth. When the giddy, heart-melting bonds are broken, that's when love gets serious. Joseph loved Mary. Mary broke his heart. Out of practicality or even pettiness, Joseph could have justifiably publicly divorced her. But Joseph loved Mary beyond what righteousness required. And so he made a choice that he didn't have to make, choosing a path that protected her and exposed him. And we can stop right there in Joseph's story. His example of loving beyond the warm feelings sufficiently challenges us this Advent season. But this is not the end of Joseph's story. For then an angel of God came to Joseph in a dream and told him to take Mary as his wife. Do not be satisfied with turning Mary away quietly with respect for her reputation. Welcome her into your home and build a life. Build a life, build a family, build a community. God's love is more than respect for others. It's more than forgiveness, and it's even more than compassion. The love we are called to at Advent is the love through which we embrace even those whom we would prefer to keep at a distance, choosing instead to build community together. Joseph was a man of few words, and it's possible that his time with Jesus was short. But in the ministry of Jesus, which Michael describes as brimming with calm storms, healed bodies, restored mind, and the offering of unexpected meals to the hungry, we can see that God's love lived out through Joseph had left its mark on Jesus' heart. Amen. Will you join me for our final hymn, number 22? to live out a love that defies all expectations. Amen.